in San Francisco and Immaculate Heart Radio. Welcome to the show.
Hi.
Hey, Bill. Why are you Protestant?
So basically, my main reason, I like the, I guess, the historical argument for the Catholic Church. I think that's, mm-hmm. it's a good argument. Mm-hmm. However, somewhere along down the line, the Pope became infallible, and then he, dogmatically defined in 1854 that Mary is the Immaculate Conception.
Yeah.
And I just don't understand how can the Pope just make stuff up randomly?
Oh, okay, great question. Is the definition of the Immaculate Conception a something made up randomly, Trent Horn?
No, not at all. At least it's not something that appeared out of thin air in the year 1854. The Immaculate Conception is a doctrine going back to the early centuries of the Church. We see it, for example, in early Church Fathers who spoke of Mary as the new Eve, who spoke of her as being without sin or without stain.
And for people who don't know what the Immaculate Conception is, it's often mistaken for the virgin birth.
Right.
But the Immaculate Conception
or the Annunciation, or the Incarnation.
Or the Incarnation itself. But for clarity, what is the Immaculate Conception refer
to? Immaculate Conception means that Mary was conceived, unlike the rest of us who are conceived in a state of original sin that's mm-hmm. removed through baptism.
Yep.
Mary, the graces Christ merited on the cross were applied retroactively to Mary to protect her from the stain of original sin, because that would be fitting that she would not be stained with original sin, since through her body mm-hmm. came the body of our Savior, who himself is also without sin.
And as the letter to Hebrews says, saved us through his body that he got through his mother.
So, right. So I guess, Bill, one, the Immaculate Conception does have a pedigree long before the 19th century when it was defined, just as the doctrine of the Trinity had a long pedigree before it was defined at the Council of Nicaea. Typically, doctrine is defined when it's disputed, not when it first comes into existence. Second, I guess I would ask you, why do you believe at least that, let's say, for example, when St. Peter wrote 1 Peter and 2 Peter, God kept him from writing errors in those two letters?
Yeah, I do.
Okay, so we believe Peter is the first pope, and so that we actually have common ground that we believe Peter was infallible when he wrote those two letters.
And inspired in that case.
Yes, yeah, not only inspired, but infallible. Bill, what do you understand the Church's teaching of infallibility to mean exactly? What do you think it means when we say the Pope is infallible? Hello?
Bill, you there?
What's that?
What do you think we mean by that term?
Well, essentially that he's able to create dogmas within the Church that you cannot disbelieve in.
That's not how the definition of infallibility pertains to the Pope. It's basically this. The Pope is infallible. It's a charism of his office as the successor of Peter. In Luke's Gospel, we read Jesus telling St. Peter, he says, Simon, Simon, I think it's Luke 23, Simon, Simon, Satan wants to sift you all as wheat, but I have prayed that your faith may not fail. Go and strengthen your brothers. A special charism was given to Peter that his faith wouldn't fail and he would strengthen his brethren. So the Pope, as the successor of Peter's office as the Bishop of Rome, the Bishop over the whole Church, retains this charism and infallibility. It does not mean whatever the Pope says becomes dogma. What it means is when the Pope gives a special declaration from his chair as his authority as of Peter, ex cathedra, then that declaration, when it pertains to faith and morals, will not contain any errors. So the Pope will not lead the Church into error in a formal way. What do you have grounds to say the Church, that the Pope led us into error with the Immaculate Conception, or what do you think on that? I mean, why do you think he can't have this, that Christ wouldn't protect his Church in this way?
The Immaculate Conception to me seems confusing because correct me if I'm wrong, but wasn't Jesus supposed to be the one who leads a sinless life in order for the redemption? Why couldn't Mary have been, since she was sinless, why couldn't Mary have been the main redeemer and then Mary could have died on the cross?
That's an excellent follow-up question.
That's a good question because it's not merely one must be sinless in order to offer a sacrifice to take away sins, but one can't merely be sinless. Because Christ is able to atone for the sins of mankind because he's fully God and fully man and lived a perfect sinless life in obedience to God, obedience even unto death on a cross. So the fact that Jesus is fully divine, that's the only reason the atonement can be universal and can make up for the infinite injustice caused by our sins. Now, actually, the Bible does speak of many people who never personally sinned. I believe it's in Paul's letter to the Romans, he talks about how Jacob and Esau wrestled in the womb. This before they were born, Paul specifically says, before they did anything good or bad. So we think of infants, for example, have never committed a personal sin in their lives. If they die, you know, right after birth, they've never committed a sin. Now, those deaths can't atone for anyone because they don't have an infinite divine nature with them. So what the church teaches is, Bill, is that Mary's Immaculate Conception, it's a fitting truth that as the mother of the Savior who brought, who gave the body, I think this is in Hebrews 10:35, that Christ had a body prepared that he redeemed the world with, that this body came from his mother, you know, he's the same flesh as her, and her flesh was not stained with original sin. That's all it is. And I don't see where Scripture contradicts that teaching.
So why is it that the infallibility of the Pope wasn't even dogmatically defined until, you know, halfway through the Catholic Church?
Well, the issue of papal infallibility was defined at the First Vatican Council. You're correct on that point.
Even more recent than halfway.
Right, yes, in the year, I believe in the year 1870.
Yeah.
And I've brought that up before, is that certain doctrines of the Church are only defined when there is a dispute arising related to them. The Church doesn't necessarily declare everything right at the very beginning. We have, you know, the doctrine of the Trinity. The doctrine of Mary, the Mother of God, was defined later. We were talking about the monothelitist heresy at the very, very beginning of the first hour. Mm-hmm. That wasn't defined as a heresy until almost 600 years after Christ.
Back to the infallibility of the Pope being defined late in the game, but in an official way,
but it was never challenged. It wasn't challenged, and you can go to our website, Bill, at catholic.com, and look up the infallibility of the Pope, and you can see passages from the early church fathers. Cyprian of Carthage would be one good example of those who say that we must accede to the authority of the Bishop of Rome, from whom no mm-hmm. error can flow. So we see that the doctrines are understood then, at least in an indirect way, but the Church hesitates to formally define things
yeah.
until there's a dispute that arises.
Intelligent questions, Bill. I hope you keep in touch. Catholic.com is our website.
Oh, yeah. And Bill, I hope you're listening or others are listening. Yeah. If you want more on the papacy, a good book on that would be a book by Patrick Madrid called Pope Fiction. He has
yeah.
several passages, chapters that deal with the infallibility of the Pope there.
And dealing with bad popes. All of whom were actually also infallible.
That's right. Because infallibility doesn't mean you'll always be a good guy.
Right,
you won't commit a sin.
Right.
It's not impeccability. It just means you won't lead the Church into error.